Okay, in our previous videos dealing with conservation of mass, we applied conservation law to a differential or a very tiny sized control volume and expressed the net accumulation rate of mass inside this volume relative to the inflow and outflow of mass through the boundaries. So in this video, we're going to take a little bit different approach. Instead of looking at a differentially small volume, we're going to consider an arbitrary volume. So this could be any size, not just a tiny cube. It could be any shape. And let's see what happens for this case. So if I'm going to draw an arbitrary volume. So this is a three-dimensional picture now. This isn't a 2D projection. It's like a potato, I guess you can think of it, in space. And if I want to express conservation of mass inside this potato-shaped region, I can do it as follows. So the net accumulation inside the volume is the rate of change of density, d rho dt, mass per unit volume times volume. So the time rate of change of mass inside the volume is equal to the net flow of mass through the boundaries. And so that's expressed by the surface integral, rho v dot n dA. So the mass flow rate per unit area integrated over the area. And you can see that this, by taking this vector notation, this accounts for both inflow and outflow, because if the velocity and the normal vector to the surface are pointing in the same direction, then those are going to have a particular sign. But if the velocity vector is pointing in the opposite direction of the normal vector, then they'll have the opposite sign. So this integral accounts for both inflow and outflow through the boundaries. Now we can, you may remember from vector calculus possibly, that there's a way, a mathematical way, that you can convert a surface integral like this one into a volume integral. And that theorem, or that approach, is called Gauss's theorem. And so we can apply that as follows. The integral over the surface v dot n dA becomes integral over the volume of del dot v d volume. So if we apply this to transform this area integral into a volume integral, we can make an interesting observation here. So let's apply that to the equation above. So we have the accumulation term, the integral over the volume, plus now also the integral over the volume of del dot rho v equals zero. And this is also integrated over the volume. Okay, let me go to the next slide and just rewrite it here. Okay, so notice that we can recover the differential form of the continuity equation just by looking at these terms. And I'll show you how we can do that. So notice that, you know, the sum of these two, these are both volume integral. So we could combine these terms together into one integral because they're both integrated over the same domain. And so if the integral of something equals to zero always, then in order for this to be true, the only way that this can be true always is if this something equals to zero. So that something then is the sum of these two terms, the sum of these two integrands, d rho dt plus del dot rho v equals zero. So this then should look familiar. This is the differential form of the continuity equation that we derived in the last series of videos. Okay, so both approaches are identical. That's the point of going through this exercise, to show that we get exactly the same relationship either way that we look at it, whether we consider at first the differential size volume or whether we apply it to a macroscopic volume. But now let's go back and look at what we find for some different limiting cases for the integral form. So first we'll consider incompressible flow. And remember the case of incompressible flow. Incompressible means that the density of the fluid is constant. So let's look at the two terms associated with this equation. So the first term is d rho dt equals zero. So if the density is constant, then d rho dt is zero. So then this integral is equal to zero. Okay, so the first term is equal to zero for incompressible flow. So now let's look at the other term of the equation, the integral over the surface. So again, we're going back to the original form of the equation before we applied Gauss's theorem. So we have the integral over the surface area of rho v dot nda, the mass flow per unit area. And let's look at the units associated with these terms. So density is mass per unit volume. V dot n, that's just the velocity component normal to the surface, that's meters per second. And area has units of square meters. So this term has units of mass per time because you have meters cubed in the denominator and meters cubed in the numerator. So this is an expression of the mass flow rate of the system. Okay. Now, since the density is constant, we can factor this term out, right? So this comes out of the integral, and since this term is equal to zero, it can be canceled out. And so what we're left with then is this simplified form for incompressible, subject to the assumption of incompressible flow. So we have the integral over the surface of v dot nda. Again, if we look at the units, we have velocity meters per second times area meters squared. So this has units of volume per time. So this is a volume flow rate, and we usually denote that as Q. Mass flow rate we usually denote as m dot. So for the case of incompressible flow, the conservation of mass can be reduced to an expression of the conservation of volume of the fluid, only for the case of incompressible flow. But that's an important assumption because a lot of the flows that we're going to deal with involve liquids, which for most part can be considered incompressible fluids.